Haley or Nancy know if you're interested in going so that they can get them an idea of how many would be there. There will not be morning prayer tomorrow morning. We'll return to normal schedule on Tuesday.
Yes, our monthly trip to serve dinner at the City Mission will be on the 19th, which is a Friday, from 4 to 6:30 as usual. So let me know if you'd like to help with that. And then we have rescheduled the baking day. It's going to be on the 27th, Saturday, starting at 9:30. So that's appropriate for all ages. You can sit down while you're making the cookies. It'll be very nice. We'll have basic baking supplies. You can, of course, bring whatever you want to add to that. So the 27th, Saturday.
Great. We will resume Christian education for all ages next week, and continuing on the second and fourth Sundays of each month. And then 2 weeks from today is our annual meeting, and there will be a potluck or a carry-in, as they call it around here. So put that in your calendars as well. Anything else? Barb?
Yeah.
Think offering, I'm sorry.
Yes. I want to say thank you to all the members of the choir who participated in Christmas Eve service, and to Holly for coming.
Anything else? Once again,
Thank you.
whom they perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
you, Lord Christ. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And there went out to him all the country of Judea and all the people of Jerusalem. And they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and had a leather girdle around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the thong of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens open and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "Thou art my beloved Son. With thee I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Particularly special about the water in the Jordan River, assembled crowd, through the descent of the Holy Spirit as a dove, and through the voice of God the Father, that he, Jesus, was indeed true God of true God, a part of the Godhead. Our relationship with the triune God is affected with regular old water, which by the grace of God becomes something extraordinary. When I baptize somebody, I don't go and get special water from somewhere. It's just out of the tap. It's ordinary stuff. But by the grace of God, it and we become extraordinary. The mystery of salvation, of Christ's death and resurrection, is made known to us, as I said, not through an act of mystical transcendence, but through ordinary water and ordinary bread and ordinary wine, which by the grace of God become extraordinary. We learn from this morning's lesson from Acts that the presence of the Holy Spirit is brought about not by transcendental meditation, but through the laying on of physical apostolic hands onto flesh and blood people. Just as today the grace of the Holy Spirit is made real, something happens, to use a fancy theological term, ontologically, that is, at the very core of our being, when, say, the successors of those first apostles, our bishops, lay their hands, ordinary old hands, nothing special about the bishop's hands, though my bishop back in Arkansas once said that his hands were insured by church insurance more than the rest of the body. I think he was joking. They're just ordinary human hands, but through it, God can confirm or ordain some bodies. Anyway, baptism is also about more than the remission of sins, though for us sinners, that's certainly a big part of it, the most important part. Baptism is also about the ability of God to create a relationship with flesh and blood people in the material world, the washing away of the stain of original sin being the first step in that. It's about Christ being known not primarily by spiritual athletes who stay in their monastic cells and pray and study a lot, as edifying as those practices are, nor is it about having some grand spiritual experience. Again, that's not a bad thing. I wish that we could all have a grand spiritual experience. But that's not the point here. The power and glory of God is made present in the midst of the ordinary. Water, bread, wine, flesh, and blood. The grace of God is made present in the gathering of flesh and blood people, like all of you in the pews, who've been regenerated by the Holy Spirit and strive to maintain holy relationships with God and with each other. As Anglican Christians, we are often said to have a particularly incarnational view of the Christian faith, which is to say that the reality of God becoming human in Jesus makes all the difference for how we view the rest of the world. So Jesus, God, found this world an appropriate place to enter as a part of creation, as a human being. And so the world has been blessed, has been graced by that, and is no longer just a place for stumbling blocks, though it is that, it being a fallen world. But it has also become the locus of God's saving work for all humanity. Christ's incarnation, his baptism at the Jordan, his whole life, his physical, real, bodily death, his real, physical, bodily resurrection, all point to the fact that the way to holiness is not through world denial, but by being Christian. make his presence known around us in the midst of that which is commonplace, whether water, bread, wine, or human beings. It's ordinary things that serve as the vessels God uses to make his grace known and felt. All of the saints, by which I mean the capital S saints, were sinners too, ordinary people. But God made them, as one of our prayers puts it, the special lights, his special lights in their generations. God does this for us still, all the time. But how much more wonderful is it when we recognize it? In plain old water that I get out of the tap. In bread that hardly counts as bread. Have you ever thought about that? It's hardly bread. In cheap wine. These tailored tawny pork, which is not top shelf stuff. And in the person sitting right next to him, in the midst of ordinary stuff, it takes a great God to forego thunderbolts. That's not the God of the Bible, by the way, that's Zeus. It takes a great God to forego a booming voice, which we did get in today's gospel, but which we don't ordinarily hear when we're out and about on the streets of Finlay. God forgoes those, forwent them, and made himself like us, and makes himself known still in the ordinary. Now that takes a God who values us, who values our experience, who wants to be in relationship with us all the time, right now, and in eternity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made, for us and for our salvation. Came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic Apostolic Church. We acknowledge the baptism of the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the Church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others, and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to our Son in the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Joseph, her spouse, the holy apostles Peter and Paul, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Christ, in everlasting. Body of our Lord Jesus 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 Christ, in everlasting. Thank you.
better term.